Hi guys, welcome everybody. We're here for our December edition of our masterclass. I have the very distinct pleasure of welcoming my friend and now partner of sorts, Mike Black from Jet Fresh Floral Distributors out of Miami, Florida. And we're just really excited to jump in here with you, Mike, today and introduce you to anybody that is on our platform. And if they're not familiar with your company, you should start following them right now today. But this is our very own Mike Black. So welcome, Mike. Thank you for joining.
Well, thank you for having me. And we just did a couple minute warm up before this. So I just wanted to, I was waiting to the time that you had people in here. I want to thank you and your amazing team for believing in what we believe in and for allowing us to be that partner that you've been looking for. And I want you to know that it means a lot to us. And we got just such a long road ahead. I'm just very excited about all these things that are coming with the details.
Aw, thank you. That's really nice to hear. I was very excited about this too, because I've really dreamed for a long time to make this a part of like what Details does or how they can provide like more service to our customers. And it, you know, I just feel like it's a very, a great synergy that both of our companies share and with like-minded vision. So I'm just really happy that you have just, your team has just really stepped up to the plate, and we just love you guys. The more we get to know you, we just love you. So anybody that isn't familiar with them at all, you need to get on the bandwagon, because we are very proud to have you here. I know you have like a very long history in the floral industry, and the more I get to know you, the more I'm just so inspired by like your early beginnings. But would you love to like, or would you care to share like how you got started in this industry, where your roots really began?
Sure. No, it's a long story, but I'll give you the short version. My family had a wholesale florist in the New York City flower market since the 1930s. And it was my dad, his dad, my uncle, and a cast of characters that I'll never forget as long as I live. And I would work every possible minute since I was like 12 or 13 years old. My dad let me come down there to sweep the floors or whatever. I just couldn't wait to go there. The hours were not so great. We started at 3 to 4 in the morning most days. And well, we got to go home in the afternoons. But anyway, I was kind of like finished with school. I just was in love with the business. I had no other, I wanted to do something else professionally, but my dad showed me that wouldn't be the right financial decision for me, so I didn't do it. So I just hung in there with him, and yeah. I started at, I think it was 16 or 17, I was working full time, and you know, I did everything. I was a driver for a long time. And then from there, I had the genius idea probably 10 years in, 12 years in, that the supermarkets were the future. And I started to dabble and make some bouquets. And I went ahead and left from my dad and started a bouquet company. And that did really well for about 10 years, and then it didn't do too well. And my dad was had already closed his business, and he moved to Florida. And he gave me the opportunity to come down and work with them. After it didn't work out for me in the bouquet business. So I moved down here first, and then I brought my family down a little later, and I worked for a company here for about 10 years again. And I learned a lot about how it works here in Miami that I didn't really know when I was up in New York. And I was really intrigued by the business, how it works here in Miami. And I began to just gain a lot of experience doing that part of the game, and then didn't work out there either. So I went out in the world and started my own company here in Miami, which is JetFresh. We started about 14 years ago.
Yeah, you know, I took a trip this summer to New York just to see the flower market there. And you were one of the main people off of my Facebook feed that was commenting. You were like, oh my gosh, that's home. It's home for me. And I just think about that life of all those florists that are working in that city. And I just can't imagine, you know, their daily, just their daily activities and how the space is just so small, and what they do and how much flowers are flowing in and out of there.
Yeah. So what you see today is not what I experienced. What I experienced was 30, 40 wholesalers all next door to each other on four different streets.
I think it's like one street now. So
it's all changed now. I mean, there are some that are still there that I'm still friends with today that, you know, guys that I grew up with are still on 28th Street. But, you know, it's a tough deal for them because the real estate just is so expensive, and they're building all these boutique hotels, and they rezone the area for high rise. So once they rezone the area for high rises, then the market never really moved the way it should have moved. I remember years ago they had opportunities to move, but everyone couldn't agree, so it just never happened.
It's more the charm of everything you see in the movies, but I really feel like the hub of the floral industry is in the city of Miami, and specifically in Doral. Right there. I know that you guys just got the City of Flowers was designated that, but if you go and see the operation, I love your whole business you've created there. I feel like was really nice. I had the opportunity to walk through and see your facilities, I think like a couple months ago. And it reminded me a lot of the market, like your coolers in there, how you have it for walk-in customers with all the valances and just the way it's like you create that New York atmosphere. And in the flower of New York, or
that's what we wanted to do. Yeah, we wanted to put. You could take me any direction in the flower business. I will always wish I could teleport back to when I was, 20.
Yeah,
working in the flower market, having florists call and say, "I need 50 red carnations, 100 red roses, 6 bunches of gyp, and 5 letter leaf, and drop it off on your way home." Click.
Yeah,
that was my favorite thing to do. I love the action. I love the interaction. I love the yelling, the screaming, and arguing, and the practical jokes. It just goes on forever and ever.
Well, and I feel like that's what you've made there with your office, because you do have a really great, unique cast of characters. A lot of them are in your family too, and a lot of them become family. I feel like since the longer I've known you, it's like everybody that works for you seems like they're all in your family. So any advice you can give for hiring or creating that kind of culture?
I hire a lot of potheads.
Yeah, I noticed that too.
I hire a lot of potheads and creative people, and we like to joke, and we're kind of like the land of the misfit toys, if you ever see that cartoon around this time every year. So it's all people that have been other places but didn't quite fit in there, or didn't excel there, or didn't have the freedom and the creative freedom and just the encouragement, whatever it might have been. And then they come here and they just do really well. They just fit right in and do really well. And, I like crazy. I like people who are,
I know you've got a lot of tchotchkes on your desk, I noticed. I get lost for hours, playing with all your McDonald's toys and so.
Yeah, well, when I used to be in sales, I used to have all my noisemakers and stuff, and I used to have fun with the customers on the phone all the time. But now it's kind of like email and Skypes and WhatsApps now. But when you were on the phone, it was a whole different vibe, It's but the emails are kind of like.
Yeah.
So
20 years ago, I worked for an import company selling boxes of flowers. And that's where really I thought details needed to grow into be something that was recognizing like all those pieces. But yes, you create so many relationships with people or these wholesalers or these people working in the market just by that conversations daily, like, what do you need? How can I help you? Like, what is going to make it? And it is a lot of screaming and yelling and looking at the prices. I feel like it was like the stock market. It was just such a crazy experience, especially when you get all that Cuban coffee flowing through your veins deliveries. So
What about when you call and they get the famous answer, I'm all set, click.
Yeah, notorious for that. Those J.W. Perrys, I remember, they were just brutally mean and so forth. Yeah. But when you're wanting to create relationships, I know the noisemakers, and that is definitely a way to set yourself apart. Any big differences you think in the culture, like Miami from New York? Like, I feel like you probably were fish out of water coming from New York.
No, when I got here, I didn't really understand it. A lot of people were sleeping down here when I got here. When I got here, the companies were making really good margins and the costs were not nearly what they are today. And, lunchtime was an hour and happy hour wasn't at 4, it was at 3. And, you know, there would be a lot of voicemails wherever you called around town after 2 p.m. And I found it like, okay, well, I work 24 hours a day. So that it was pretty easy to make things happen when I first got down here.
Yep.
The culture here is different than what it was in New York. In New York, it was more of a grind.
Yeah.
I
can see that, because I feel like everybody's just so claustrophobic or on top of each other. Like, you're really fighting with your neighbors to get that business. So I think that, you know, Miami is just so much more spread out. I think that.
No, it's kind of the same now in Miami. Everyone's chasing the same dollar here. Yeah. No one's exempt for it. If you're not selling supermarkets, if you're just selling traditional mainstream, it's a grind again. It is a grind. And it is, people have too many choices, too many choices. And so you got to really chase the business. It doesn't come to you freely. You have to really work hard and you need to, the first sale is kind of easy. It's the repeat business that you really got to work hard for. And that's what we do. We work hard for the second order.
Well, I feel like you guys are just really setting the bar really high and pushing out there as far as your marketing is going and just getting really good attention as far as what your brand is. Like, I feel like you're also changing the game in the whole industry for a lot of people or like making them think about how to do business or operate differently. So what has been the biggest like standout for you in your like evolution over the last 14 years? What do you think you guys are doing different than some of the other people, or do you not want to say?
No, I mean, I don't think we did. We, meaning me or my, you know, the people that have been here with me since the beginning. The only thing different we did is just be us and be real. And what's given me a leg up is that I have done so many things in the flower business that I can clearly understand what's expected on the other side versus a traditional import company, you know, maybe even people with an MBA and all kind of certifications and diplomas. They didn't understand what it is to be a wholesale florist and what a wholesale or a retail florist for that matter, or a bouquet maker. What do they expect when they open the box? What do they, you know, or there's the word called loyalty, which is the very first thing I teach everybody that works for me, is that we don't treat customers with any disloyalty. There needs to be some loyalty. If people buy from you and are loyal to you, you have an obligation to be loyal to them. Versus a lot of, I won't say a lot of our competitors, but some of our competitors, you know, they don't see it that way. And we've got a lot of customers over the years from competitors that disappointed customers.
Yeah.
So we were able to be in the right place at the right time, and we were able to fix a problem that someone else created.
Yeah. And that's I've watched you over the last few months specifically really step up to the plate when, you know, there's a last minute order or something goes wrong with someone's refrigeration or something. And you have really just gone, I feel like, above and beyond to make your customers know how valued and appreciated they are by just like making it happen or making certain phone calls to other wholesalers. And, you know, I just have really admired your business and like how much you care. So I just to let all of our customers know here that are on the call, it's just like JetFresh is going above and beyond, especially when things have been so hard to get recently. I mean, how did you guys deal with all of that constraint, I guess, on flowers that's been happening?
So we're loyal to a lot of our suppliers, and we take product even when we don't need it, and we expect them to do the same for us. I mean, but we haven't disappointed many customers, especially during the shortage. We're able to find flowers at very expensive prices or whatever, but we were able to fill most of our orders. We didn't disappoint too many people. And all through COVID, we've been helping people that we never heard of before. We've been helping we were ready to turn on the switch shortly after COVID shut everything down. As cities opened up slowly, some people that we don't know, we'd never heard of before, they were displaced. Their suppliers were closed, or they couldn't get inventory, or it was whatever the case may be. We try to figure out a way to help them, even if it was a temporary situation, even if it was just because their local guy was closed and the local guy reopened and they went back to him. That was or them. That was always fine with us. You know, we just tried to keep the industry with our little contribution to keep the industry moving.
Yeah. So, and this partnership, I know we've been discussing it for a while, but I feel like when we were about to launch, it seems like everything had tightened up. And so we were like, well, let's hold off because we didn't really want people to get excited or, ask for a lot of things because you were really concerned about servicing your current customer base and making sure they got all their products. So that was like a nice thing to hear because you're looking out for them or the person that's sending you those orders week after week. You want to make sure that you get them their products. So I'm excited because we've started working with clients in Florida to offer your products. And we have good intentions to go throughout our other markets that we're working with customers because we hear time and again, they're looking for new people to try or their wholesaler has maybe disappointed them in some area and they're looking for new people. So I definitely see where one person's mistake can open them up to you as a potential future client. But we're just really excited for our customers to have this ability to send the order very easily. Are there any hopes that you have from this relationship or reaching those new markets maybe you haven't serviced yet?
So to speak to about what we're doing with details and starting out in Florida, it's because I believe that most customers that have been in the business for a while have been spoiled. Mm-hmm. And it's been easy for them to pick up the phone and get whatever they need at a fair price and pretty quickly. But then came COVID, and there are so many problems that their normal supplier needs to deal with on a daily basis. Most of it has to do with logistics at this point. Not much has to do with supply. Mm. But there are some peaks and valleys of supply. Like we went through that 3 months with no white roses and, but the big problem is the logistics, including FedEx and UPS and all these overnight companies. These people are not having an easy time.
Yeah.
So, I won't say in all cases, but in a lot of cases that I've heard about, that I've talked to people about, you know, them being pissed off at their wholesaler because they disappointed them or whatever, you know, that isn't really the case. The wholesaler hasn't disappointed anyone. For example, right now, I have hundreds of boxes in Ecuador that I can't fly out. There's no plane. No matter, it's not even a matter of price, what I'm willing to pay. I can't fly it out. There's no available airspace. So everybody in this business is faced with the same problems. And these problems are not going away anytime soon. And so we can't put the blame on the wholesaler. The wholesaler is those of them that are out there that are reputable, that have been in business for quite some time, are killing themselves to try to make their customers' orders what they want them to be. But there's too many problems, there's too many potholes on the road to get there at any reasonable speed. So they can't buy like they used to buy.
Yeah.
They can't buy like they used to buy. They can't order, you know, 20 minutes after they got their deposit and say, okay, it's on. I need these flowers. They can't do that anymore. They have to buy a week earlier. They have to put their orders in at least a week earlier than they normally would. And they got to be willing to take substitutions. And they need to sell their events with that in mind. Because anyone could promise you anything. And then when the plane don't come in, it's a problem. There's a litany. And I like that word, litany. I just started using it recently. There's a litany of dot-com companies selling flowers to consumers, to florists, to whoever, what they call overnight express or 48-hour express directly from the farm or directly from Miami or California or Canada, wherever they're coming from. And those flowers aren't showing up on time.
Yeah.
There's lost boxes. They don't come. It's a lot of problems. So that's not the answer either.
Yeah.
I think the idea that we have, the concept that we have, as having the customers find the information on the details platform that your customers that are using details to sell their events and to do their costing and to do their planning, they have a way to, with the push of a button, to figure out, you know, what are they going to need. And then if they could have a way to send that through the system to just one place, they could put that order together and then strategically get those flowers to them by utilizing their existing wholesaler. It's like, it's no different than FTD or Teleflora. One of these guys, they're order gatherers. They take the orders and then they send it to a retail florist, or they'll FedEx a box that might or might not make it. Right.
So what we're trying to do here with Mike and details is basically have them as the main source, and then they have relationships with different wholesalers that can ship the product to maybe your local wholesaler, but that it all gets pretty much consolidated down so that it stays within the cold storage chain, and that the flowers have the freshest less time in an airplane out of refrigeration, because our customers ultimately pay the price on if those flowers last or not, if they're kept too long out of this storage situation. So we're starting here in Florida, but what we really would love to see is event florists putting their orders together sooner, or at least sending them sooner. I guess that was like the biggest problem most wholesalers have, is like that time of, it can't be 5 days out before the event anymore, just because it just can't logistically happen that way, is what I'm hearing.
That's right. They have less air freight, they have less over the road trucks, they have less of everything. Mm-hmm. And they themselves need to figure out and coordinate how to get all these moving, all these different ingredients into their location at one time. So our plan and what we've done is we're starting with Florida, because we feel if we screw up, we can fix it quickly. And we're starting something new. We've never done this before. And we don't want to disappoint anyone. So we feel that, and we've partnered with Carlstead's in the state of Florida, north of Orlando. Orlando and north, all the orders that we're getting are going through Carlstead's Flower General. And it's leaving Miami consolidated on their truck. Yeah. And it goes to their location. And then they have the time to also take on any little add-ons that might be for that order, or maybe perhaps take some orders for hard goods that they need for that order, and then have it all delivered like they would normally get it delivered by their wholesale florist in one delivery, a nice organized delivery where it's not where something's missing. That's the plan. Yeah.
So what I truly envision and seeing for the future is really getting you guys some type of alert system that might be like, hey, it's time to send those orders in for this specific date, et cetera. And if you use the items that are currently in the JetFresh collection, which I know you guys put a ton of time into making sure you have items that are featured almost year round for all of these items, but you've went in there and put and set different pricing structures on them that you feel really confident that you can get them these prices by, which is really, really amazing. So if you are using those products in your events and you send those orders to JetFresh, you're almost assuredly, if you can get it to them in enough time, going to get that product at that price. So, and actually we have a new feature that's coming out soon, Mike, that I'm really excited about, but it's like a little wand, like a magic wand button that will reset all the cost in your worksheet to like update to that item's price if it had changed or if you had updated it anyway. So something that's coming out in the next week or so, but I think it's really cool because if you make any changes, then with the click of a button, they could just say update to JetFresh's pricing and like the whole thing will change and they'll see if they need to charge more for something or maybe they could make more margin on something. So it's really, I feel like we're moving along in some things to give people a really great avenue to be profitable, but also help our wholesale partners allow them to be successful by giving them orders in enough time, you know, like make their job
easy. I don't think anybody in the flower business around the country can get along without their local wholesale florist.
Absolutely.
They're irreplaceable. Irreplaceable, and they need to have they need to have that ability to understand that, yeah, maybe this company is offering you X price by FedEx direct, but that company is not going to help you when you're in trouble. Your local wholesale guy or gal is always going to be your hero. They're never going to let you down. The ones that I know, they all work really hard and they all try really hard to provide really good service. But let's face it, the trend is for everyone to bypass everyone. The trend is for to buy direct in Miami or to buy direct at the farm or, you know, to get flowers any way you can to save a few bucks. And in the end, that doesn't always work out. In the end, sometimes you call your wholesaler in the 11th hour and say, oh man, I took all that business away from you, but I need this, can you help me? And they'll probably say, yeah, you know, so those guys, they need to have a little, you know, I always say, you know, hug your wholesaler. These people are, including us here in Miami, because here in Miami, we're wholesalers and we're always trying to help people that might be buying elsewhere or doing something with somebody else. And we can throw it out there in their face, hey, you left me, so I'm going to leave you. But we don't, you know, nobody does that. We all need business. We all need to work. You don't need to work. So hug your wholesaler and all these people. Look, if you've got a huge event and you're on a truck or you have an airline account and you're a substantial buyer and you're doing your business, okay, you know, we understand. But if you have an event that needs to fluctuating volumes of events that has no, you probably don't have an account with a trucking company. Or if you don't have a loading dock, you can't get on a trucking company. There's so many things. So you need to use your local wholesaler. And there's so many things, not just details, but a lot of wholesalers that have K2K with Comet, right? There's a wholesaler that give, there's lots of ways to buy flowers through your wholesaler. What we're trying to do is we're trying to stop all this disorganization and all this disappointment and all these fires to put out by collecting these orders through details, having the customer have that peace of mind knowing that somebody reliable is on that job and it's going to go through your local wholesaler if we can make that work. And not much changes. And the wholesaler is still skin in the game. Everyone, no one's losing out. Everyone's still retaining their business. So that's kind of like the plan. So yeah, we started in Florida and we did open it up with Carlstad's. And as we head north and as we head west, as we get better at it and as we fix all the little bumps in the road, that undoubtedly there's going to be some, and find out where our mistakes are and where our weak points are and fix all those things, then, you know, we'll call the next state or the next, you know, wholesaler in the area of a customer that with a details customer and say, hey, would you like to partner on this project? And if they're in, then great. If they're not, then we'll have to find another way. But the plan is to try to kind of like think out of the box a little bit, because I think these kind of things that we're doing with you right now with details, it's the future. We have many customers, wholesalers especially, who don't want to talk on the phone. They just want to go online and order what they need, and they expect it to be delivered on time, and that's it. And they expect to get good quality with not no headaches. Now, you know, of course, there's always going to be a bump in the road, but we have to be able to have the network to fix those bumps.
Yeah.
And we'd be foolish to not try to include.
Well, and that's the thing, is I feel like we, through this process, we're really going to ask for a lot of feedback from our customers. What works really well? What would you like to see different? And I know we request that from our customers quite a bit, and like, what is really working nicely for you, or what would you like to add? So I know we're always making updates to different features. And I think this is an area that has really lacked a lot of attention between the florist and the wholesaler, and getting these orders more like streamlined. And the first part was helping our florists get more organized. So I feel like we've got some really amazing organized florists that are in way different parts of the world than you're located. So getting them to find you, or having a similar relationship, you know, that's our goal here. So that's why I really thought they needed to be introduced to your company. And I really appreciate, Mike, how you're actually putting boots on the ground in South America too. Like you recently purchased a farm where you're growing tons of roses and doing amazing things. So I see you traveling there all the time. I'm really quite envious of this, that you're just like in South America. But explain that process, or how you even picked it, or what roses you're doing. And I know you have a few different lines.
Well, yeah, I just got back last night, actually. I was at the farm for a couple of days, so 4 years ago, we had the opportunity to buy one of our suppliers who was not doing well. And we had the opportunity to, it's a small farm. We call it a boutique farm. Right now we have about just less than 10 hectares of roses planted, of which the past 3 years we have renovated whatever was existing, and we have created a lot more selection, which will be in full production by late 2022, or early 2023.
Okay.
We are planting varieties. We're doing two things. We're planting staple wedding varieties that is always short in the market. We don't plant a lot of any one, so we're a very small farm compared to most farms in Ecuador. So we could hardly supply, you know, the whole world with flowers, but we have some staple varieties in the ground or already growing, Playa Blanca, Tibet, Quicksand, you know, all these highly demanded varieties. And then what we've been doing is we've been shopping in the breeders for the past couple of years, looking for varieties that are unique, or what we think has a lot of potential in the event business. And we also try to find varieties that the big, large groups didn't take it. Because once the big groups have it, then it's hard to compete. So we were looking for things that will be kind of special. For example, we're the first grower outside of Esmeralda to have a really cool spray rose called Green Pink. I don't know if you've seen it, but it's been my favorite spray rose for years. And when we had the opportunity to be able to get the license to grow them, we jumped right at it. We don't have spray roses on the farm. We have mostly, this is the only spray rose we have or will have because we don't have any more room. But I was just there 2 days ago and I was looking at them producing and I'm super happy with what's coming. It's beautiful, beautiful quality. And I think it fits for so many events, orders that we get because everything is usually blush, light pink, or white. And this has all of that in one. So yeah, and we have great management at the farm. The farm is led by Juanita and Carlos Coloma. Juanita's been like a sister to me. We worked in another company together, and her husband Carlos, who's the farm manager, he's my brother from another mother, and they didn't know anything about growing roses. We learned a lot, and we made a lot of rookie mistakes. But watching them now, when we walk the farm, watching them now versus 4 years ago, how they're familiar with all the diseases and they're familiar with, you know, the whole growing process from soup to nuts. They're just so familiar with it and they're a world of information now. And I'm so proud of what they've done. And I can't take credit for it. These guys have been there for, you know, I didn't go there for almost 2 years with COVID. And I've been going back for the past couple months now, but to see where we were and to see where we are now, I'm just so, so proud of them. I'm so proud of them. They've done such a great job. And you know, I can tell you one thing, guys. It's a rough deal growing roses. The investments never end and the problems never stop. And I have a new level of respect for people that grow flowers, and I've been dealing with them for so long, but I have a new level of respect for what they do. And I used to be like, you know, oh, your heads are too small. I need a price adjustment, stuff like that. Now the head's too small. I mean, well, so are mine. I understand.
I feel like you don't know it. You just don't know. And I think until you actually put boots on the ground there and can see what a wealth of knowledge you're adding to like your whole, what you know about flowers.
It's up there in my top three greatest experiences. It's up there. I absolutely love the project. I love to keep investing into it. I love the people that work there. I think that we've done a great job of building our brand globally. We ship all around the world. We have customers in the Orient, all over Europe, Russia, Canada. It's been a lot of fun. It's been a lot of fun to watch it grow and the people to watch them grow.
And I love that you're really thinking about event florists and what our needs are as you're planting, even though it's like a boutique size farm. It makes our hearts all happy to know, like, if we're a loyal customer of yours, then there's a good shot we might be able to get those Saharas when everybody else is wanting them too. So,
well, we were able to take care of a lot of customers when there weren't too many flowers around. But yeah, we took the decision to work with wholesalers and event companies years ago. Mm-hmm. Some companies here in Miami were hiding that fact that they weren't just selling to wholesalers, but we've been out of the closet the whole time. And we have nothing to hide. I mean, that's just the way the business works and everybody has their place. We used to do this with supermarkets and stuff like that, but I found them to be extremely disloyal. And they have a little bit of a bully kind of mentality when they do buying. That's just not for me. And we just walked away from it. And we just decided we're just going to focus on what we do best. And filling wedding orders is what we do best.
Yeah. Well, and those guys can be tough too. I mean, those wedding florists, I mean, we'll beat you up over, over some things. We got to make that bride happy, you know? She's a, we've got to deal with those customers.
It's a different level. It's a different level. It's a different kind of stress. It's a different kind of stress because if we create a problem, we can usually fix a problem. Mm-hmm. And with the big mass market guys, there's no room for any kind of bump in the road. If the bike doesn't take off, it's your fault. You know, everything's on you. The truck gets there a day late, it's your fault. You know, things that are just not in your control. And I was not loving it. So I'm doing what we love. I'm taking us in the direction that we love. And so far, so good.
So can I ask about your creative side? Because when I first was introduced to JetFresh, I think it was about 5 years ago at a WFSA show. This is a wholesale florist distribution conference. And you had the most amazing booth set up, which you do over and over again, but it was like, I think a roulette table that you had made out of preserved roses. And I think your son Ryan was in charge of this. You have a lot of your boys. I think you have five boys. Only two of them work for you now, I think, but we can jump into that if that's something. But where do you guys come up with these ideas on all these crazy things you put together? And it's really amazing. I feel like you set the standard. I know recently at a show, I think Rafi, who's on the call, might have helped you with your past booth. Maybe it was the PMA conference
No, they helped us with the World Floral Expo here in Miami. Ryan and Ashley like to collaborate with Petal Production staff because they are so highly.
We love you, Rafi. Thank you. He did my booth too for the Last of Sub conference. But
Ryan and Ashley. Well, first of all, like when my son Ryan graduated from college, he graduated with I think he took computer animation and graphic design. He graduated from FAU and he came and worked with us probably in the company's just a couple years old, and we started to screw around with videos on YouTube and Facebook and we took that, we just like to have fun with it. And we just kept going. And Ryan is just so, so talented. He's just a gifted person. He's just so talented in taking an idea. It's like planting a seed and putting some water and then it just grows. It's like, that's how it is with Ryan. You give him an idea or you give him a concept or we'll just make a video and he'll just put some funny shit in there. He'll just make it so it's funny or it's entertaining and
Stooges.
or I'll give him a song or somebody will give him something and he'll just take it so much further than what you expected it to go. And then, you know, his wife Ashley went to college and she's a journalist. So she writes everything and she, you know, him and her and Ryan, they sit together and say, well, what booth are we going to do this year? And then they'll come and they'll have all these ideas and then we'll talk about it. And then we figure out, oh shit, what it's going to cost. And then we'll work it out. And they always blow your mind. They always come out because like they're so free to do what they want.
Yeah.
They're so free to think out of the box. They have no handcuffs. They're like, okay, well, you know, sometimes I'll look at the invoices or I look at the American Express bill and I'll say, well, what are we buying here? You know, what is all this? And it's probably Ryan. It pays off in the end because it got us a lot of, it makes our little company look a lot bigger than what we are. It gives us a lot of reach around the world. You know, it's look, man, my dad used to tell me, it's pretty simple. If you can make them laugh, you can make them buy.
Yeah. Well, you know? And I think it just goes to the human side of the brand. So it's like, you guys are like a rough fraternity over there with the exception of Ashley and Lily.
I just think that we want to come off like, we're like you, we do what you do. You know, we're working 6-7 days too, where everything you're doing, we're doing, you know, we want to just come off that way. And We like to poke fun at a lot of stuff.
Yeah. And
we like to involve our people. We like to have our people involved in all of that. We don't.
There's so many things going on here. Your wall of fame. I think Carlos, Rafi and Carlos are on the wall several times, but you've got this like whole wall of fame of just the experiences of working with like what you've done over the years and so many awards. Notably, some of your sales rep have won some national awards even for being like the best flower salesperson. And I watch your team really go out and I've seen you send pizza to some of your customers like on like a really hard day or a busy weekend. And I'm just like, wow, what a great idea, you know? And I think that they appreciate that and that keeps them obviously wanting to buy more flowers from you, but it's really a more personal approach to doing business, which I think gets lost between all the emails and stuff. So I feel like that's what we're trying to do with humanizing it, but I do realize there's a ton of clicking involved and it's just like click, click, and you could be done. But we really want to put a face to like the brands or even our brand. You know, we want our customers to know, hey, we're real people. We really care about what you're doing. And
I think you guys do a great job about that. I mean, I think you guys are pretty laid back as well. But going back to the pictures on the wall, I mean, definitely the most popular pictures are the nudes of Carlos and Flav.
Yes.
Those are definitely the most popular ones. And there's a bunch more that isn't hung up yet.
Those
are the most popular. And, you know, I mean, look, I like to surround everybody with good vibes because this business is a stressful business and everyone's moody and everyone's bitchy and everyone, you know, likes to like get into it. But by the end of the day, they're still family, you know, and I treat these guys here as if they were my blood family because we're better together than apart. And every time they walk down the hallway and I see your pictures or they have a good memory or a customer asks a question, what happened here or who's that or why is that? It's a good feeling, you know, it's a good feeling. And I wish we had a longer hallway. I wish we had more room to put more pictures because it just reminds us every day of where we came from, who we are, where we've been, who we did it with. I mean, there's a story on every picture up there, but definitely Carlos, nudes of Carlos with flowers are the most popular.
Or the ones of you like dressed like royalty. I think I've seen you in like a general, like you had someone painted something of you as like a George Washington or something, I think. I don't know.
My son Ryan, he has a few favorites here who he likes to really make fun with. When he does, we do a different deal of the day every day. We blast out on the email every day. Ryan creates a new creative flyer for that product. And sometimes he includes, you know, people here and he'll make fun of them by putting them in there. And we think it's funny. And we just, you know, the other day it was, we did a tulip deal. So Jimmy's nickname is Jimmy the Tulip. So it's tulip time and he had Jimmy, his face, or he'll have Fern's face or my face. So he'll make fun of it. So
yeah, that's awesome. So anybody that is on details that is interested in getting an account set up with JetFresh, please just let us know, reach out to us. We'll connect the powers that be. And obviously we're looking to expand beyond Florida, but we really want to hear from you to know if this is something you're interested in, or if you'd like to see some of their flowers. And then, you have some really, really good lines that we've been getting samples from you guys. And thank you so much for the Petal It Forward flowers we got this year. But you also have been like painting some of the flowers with like cheetah designs. I've never seen anything like this before, but can I tell you, I really wanted some of those cheetah roses and for Halloween and so forth. But just the creativity that's coming out of you guys just to make our lives easier, give us something different to sell that is just like different than we've been seeing. So I appreciate and even the speaking roses I know you're doing now where you're stamping different logos and different products. Like I really want a Gucci rose. Like that to me is like—
Coming.
Yeah.
Coming.
Louis Vuitton, you know, we got to get these.
Oh, that's coming.
I know.
Oh, that's coming. So the painted rose business, the dyed rose, the tinted rose, whatever you want to call it, it's nothing new.
I used to hate it. Now, Mike, I used to hate it. There were years ago, yeah. But now I'm like, really?
Most everyone used to hate it. Most everyone, I'd say probably 90% used to hate it. But if a florist can sell a stem of roses for a lot more if it's painted than they can if it's natural, they shouldn't hate it.
Yeah, right.
If a designer or an event florist can create something with color far more than what they could have with natural roses, it's something to consider. And it's a tough pill to swallow, believe me. But we decided that we were going to get into that business and we're going to put a different twist on it. And we went to the farm and we created an entire building called our art department. We painted it everything from the 70s. Peace and Love is our, it's all about, peace, love, and jet fresh flowers. And we created a brand called Hippie Psychedelic Roses.
Yeah.
And Hippie Psychedelic Roses, we have animal prints. We have every kind of color you can imagine. We do
glow in the dark. Even glow in the dark.
We got glow in the dark. We have UV roses so we've been selling them for gender reveals. So we have a pink one and a blue one. So they take the roses, they put them in the light, and if it goes blue, it's a boy. If it goes pink, it's a girl. But as far as the speaking roses, we just got the, I'm going to show you one. Ryan stamped this morning. We have a sample machine here. Here's a Mickey Mouse.
Love it.
Stamped on the rose. So with the speaking roses, is we got into business with speaking roses. And right now we are just finishing our setup phase. One of the reasons why I have the farm is because by mid-January, we're going to be able to take any design, any logo, any words, anything that you can imagine that someone can use to sell as an upsell on an event or a corporate job or I love yous, hearts. I want to do a black one with a middle finger on it. I think that's going to sell really well. We're going to do all of these things in a matter of hours.
Yeah.
So right now it probably takes weeks to set up a new creative idea on to stamp it on a rose. We're setting it up so from idea to printing onto a rose will be a matter of hours. And that's a game changer. And we're going to have that ready by mid-January. We're going to take any concept.
Yeah, just when I start thinking of all the corporate events, here in Daytona, we did a ton of NASCAR. I can just imagine all the different things, they'd love to see their logo anywhere. So if there's any corporate events, I feel like that's a really winning combination.
Well, that's how Speaking Roses started. Speaking Roses has only recently got really into the floral game.
Yeah.
But they've been stamping roses for corporations for many years. GM, Ford, all these big names. They've been doing international corporate events for many, many years. They've only now recently started to franchise to florists and event people and to Jeff Resch, their technology and their machine. And in fact, if someone is interested, they can contact Speaking Roses and buy their own franchise. They're looking for event florists and florist customers, but
we'd love to do it
in a commercial way.
Yeah, I think we'll add a collection, and there are some new products that you guys are. I mean, your collection we just added, I think, in October. So any products that you guys have, I don't think we've included any speaking roses on there yet, but we definitely will. Or if there's a new product that you guys start growing, we would love to have that on there. And then, I don't know, we would love for you guys just to get more familiar with Jet Fresh's line. And if you do any events that might be using some products that you got from Jet Fresh, we'd love to feature that and show off the work that you're doing and show off the beautiful product, because they have relationships with farms around the world. And for, like you've heard, for over like 30 years now, Mike, I guess, this runs deep with the people you work with. So
yeah, I'm doing business with people that I've been doing business with for 30, 40 years. Yes. But we have collected some of the best farms brands that we handle. We try to focus on niche brands. We don't try to just buy from everybody. We try to build really solid relationships with our suppliers. But unfortunately, you know, the past couple of years, many of our suppliers were sold to big groups, and we lost those suppliers. So we have to find new ones. Some of them are better than the older ones, and some of them we still haven't replaced yet. But we are still able to fill our orders and take care of other customers. Some customers that might be on this recording right now doesn't give us a lot of time to do some of this work sometimes. but we somehow usually pull it out of a hat and make it happen. And that's the beauty of a family business, because we work 7 days a week. You know, we answer when we're called, you know, and we read our emails, you know, when some other people don't. So, or we answer our cell phones all the time. And I think that's the kind of level.
You shouldn't have given out that private number, Mike. You shouldn't have given out your cell phone number. You should have held that.
My phone rings 24 hours. My wife's like, oh, she sleeps right through it now. She's so used to it. The phone just because we do business like in Europe, and those guys, they start 6 hours earlier than we do. So that phone is pretty much buzzing. But that's been how it is forever. But it's really important. It's really important that to share with the your details clients that we have kissed all the frogs to find the princess.
And we have
really great brands, and our claims are pretty low. I mean, we're not perfect, but our claims are pretty low. And we're usually able to fill for a customer an order, even when it's last minute.
So just as like one final like etiquette lesson we can give our florists that are on the call or that we're going to send out in the Cliff's Notes versions, what makes a nightmare client? Who is a nightmare client for you, or what makes them a nightmare? And what is your ideal dream customer? What's the difference? What's a nightmare client? Tell us what not to do, Mike.
So, I mean, a nightmare client are just customers that are not flexible. Are not flexible and doesn't want to understand that flowers are grown, not manufactured. And the forces of nature are against us now than ever before. And everything that you've experienced in your own businesses for the past 10, 20 years, it's all changed now. None of it's the same. And if you're not willing to change with the changes, you're a nightmare customer. Great customers are mostly what we have, and those are customers that are flexible, and those are customers that understand that we are in a global pandemic. It has not gone away. It's a problem, and all the costs for everyone have gone up significantly, and the margins are getting thinner and thinner and thinner, and it's harder and harder for us to continue to be able to deliver the same level of service without the customer's cooperation. It's just getting more and more difficult.
Well, and I think that goes along for the florist clients too. It's like those nightmare clients are the ones that are inflexible or just know I want it this way and don't let you think outside the box. And then the dream clients are the ones that are like, you just take care of it and I trust you. And I think that's what we all want is from these relationships and to have that ability to say, I know you're going to do a great job for me. I trust you that you're going to look out for my behalf. So I think that's all we can all ask for, right?
So everybody should understand that there's so many flight delays that those delays, they cause condensation in the boxes of flowers. They cause dehydration in the flowers. These things are just not avoidable. It's the new norm. So if you get a box of hydrangea and the hydrangea, all stems are not 100% perfect. You got to be willing to, you know, pluck off a few flowers that got a few spots on them And those are like the nightmare customers, the ones that are just refuse to, you know, give you a little bit of help. They just want to, you know, make a claim and don't want to pay for it. And they want it replaced by FedEx at my expense and all that stuff. And we'll, you know, I mean, if we screw up, we got to fix it. But what we're looking for is partnerships, and we're looking for customers that are you know, two ways. You know, we won't go out of our way to make something not be right. You know, we're trying our best. And I think every wholesaler or every importer in Miami, everybody that I know in this industry, are all trying their very best. And this flower game is not an easy game. It's not for lazy people. Whether you're an event florist, retail florist, wholesale florist, grower, whatever. If you're not a hard worker, you ain't gonna cut it. So we need to like work with each other and understand that flowers are gonna come and if it's not exactly what you needed at the time you needed it, it's probably because it wasn't available in the time frame that we could get it to you, because everything's taking 2 or 3 days more to do, at least.
Yeah, and I wanna wrap this up, Mike, with a plug for, you have a new podcast that's coming out that's gonna be talking flowers with my good friend Fern over there at Jet Fresh. Would you care to share what is the name? What you're gonna talk about?
Yeah, it's called Two Fat Guys Talking Flowers. And it's me and the Fern Show, Fernando Ortega. He's our GM here at Jet Fresh. And he's one of the misfit toys that fit in really well here. And he's, you know, just a great person in general. And everybody loves the Fern. And he's learned a lot working here. And we just have these conversations all the time. And I said, you know what? We should just record them and put them on a podcast and start like letting other people hear our conversations. Cause sometimes, I mean, I would say we suck at it right now. We're not really, it's not great yet, but I think we're going to get there. I do think we're going to get there. I think I've had some calls from people that I know that I wouldn't even think would listen to it. That have called me and says, keep doing it. I like it. Keep doing it.
You don't know when you might want to just have something on in the background. And I feel like you're always talking about something that I just had never really ever considered. So I feel like you're one of those visionary people. And I'm just so excited to be working with you guys. And I'm glad that you guys all took the time to listen to the chat between Mike and I. And we just like to thank you, Mike. Thank you for your graciousness and for making it back from Ecuador so we could have this meeting and for being on time.
Thank you.
Yeah. And
I wish all you a happy holidays for everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks for believing in us. And we think that you're on your way to change the game with this platform and with what you're incorporating inside of your platform. I think that you're changing the game. And I think from here, it's not the end of it. I think it's going to continue to grow into something even more demanded by your clients and our clients. I think that these collaborations and these strategic partnerships are the future of our business. And I think that we haven't seen the last of it. And I think you're going to grow this into something much greater than what it is. I don't know about how huge, but it'll be just so much greater.
Yeah, is a cozy family. So I feel like we all know each other. We all have to work together. And some are a little further along in the technology area and development than others. So it makes it a little easier. But I definitely feel like it can't hurt nobody. So,
if you think about it, 20 years ago, they were faxing their orders.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember. How it's evolving, you know, it's evolving into something that now you can, you know, have your information on details and press a button and have it all break out for you. And you have how many stems you need and how, you know, what everything you need. and also an estimated budget, what it's going to cost. And that way you can easily quote that to the customer. So, you know, like I envision somehow down the road, like this somehow connecting to live inventory. I see this happening, like going further and further as we get it right. So I'm looking forward to it.
So yeah, thank you, Mike. And to all of your team, I wish you a really happy holiday, Merry Christmas. And
all that.
Oh, are you going to get them?
Everybody, come say happy holidays on the Zoom over here with the details. Come on, say happy holidays.
You guys are great. He's gonna.
That was fun. Yeah. Talking flowers.
Yeah, right.
I'm almost there.
Yay. Thank you guys for joining us.
There's Ryan. Say hi.
There's Ryan.
Come in, Ryan. How'd it go?
It went great. It went great, Ryan. We appreciate it. Are those flowers for me? You're sending me that box, right?
They're on their way to you right now.
Awesome. I love it.
You have whatever you want.
Yeah. Thank you, Mike. All the best. All right. Thank you guys. Have a great rest of your day too. And
Jet came in here.
Oh, the dog.
Can I get the camera on Jet? Let me see.
Yeah, we're gonna get the dog. Oh, there's Jet.
Jet, say hi. Say hi. Can you see him?
Yes, I do. He's beautiful. I love it. Love a Siberian Husky.
Oh, he's a husky for sure. There's a dog on the farm.
Oh, look at Fern Man. Yeah, that looks like Florida Man. Thanks, guys. I appreciate you guys. And until next time. All right. Bye, Mike.